Birshut Merev Rabotai with the permission of Hashem, I would like to wish to all of you happiness, bracha v'atzlacha. If you are on holiday, so take care, be careful, stay safe. This shiur is in the memory of Mordechai ben Yaakov Amar, zichron lebracha, as well. Unfortunately, today we lost a big tzaddik here in Israel, the Rebbe of Zdegora. And he was very young, tzaddik, 65 year old. He is a descendant of the Rojin, Rabbi Israel Merojin, Alav Shalom. At this moment that I'm talking to you, they just left the big shul in Bnei Brak to take him to the cemetery to bury him. So may his zichut be with all Am Israel in the Be'ezat Hashem. We pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu that Be'ezat Hashem, he will be a good lawyer for all of us up there, Be'ezat Hashem, with his parent. Today we will be going to Morocco, to Marrakesh, where there is a lot of tzaddikim, over more than 600 tzaddikim. I remember long time ago, they used to call Marrakesh Jerusalem, the small Jerusalem, because it was full of tzaddikim in Marrakesh. There we will be going to some tzaddikim there, not the 600 of them, only a few, because one day you go to Morocco, you go to that cemetery, you will see there a lot of tzaddikim. We have some of our family related to Rabbi Chaim Pinto that they are buried there. There is a section, a special section in the cemetery, and the cemetery is behind the palace of the king. The king of Morocco, may Hashem give him a long life. He has a few palaces, but one of his big palaces, he is not far away from where the Jewish people used to live. That is a custom that always the palace of the kings of Morocco did not live far away from the Jews, so they can protect the Jews. It's incredible. It's something that you will never see in your life. Never. No country, the palace of the king is not far away from the quarter of the Jewish people, the ghetto. I mean, on one hand, you see the big palace, the beautiful palace, and behind the palace is the ghetto, is the melach, where the Jewish people live. So, my friend, I have to tell you this. There is a pasuk in the Torah. It's a beautiful pasuk who said, Moshe Rabbeinu, he told the Bnei Israel before he passed away to keep Torah mitzvot and don't go and do what you want. I mean, a Jew cannot live his way. The Jewish people, when they were in Egypt, they were slaves to Pharaoh, and they couldn't do what they want. They were slaves. So Hashem said to Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe, it's very important that the Jewish people now, that they are free, now they have no power, so they are my people. They are my slaves. The difference between Paro and Hashem, they have deal. Paro, he was very cruel to them, but Hashem, being the slaves of Hashem, we have everything. We have everything. We have freedom, everything. But with one condition, to respect Torah mitzvah. And there is a pasuk. The pasuk said, Re'e limati etchem hukim u'mishpatim. Look, I teach you laws. Like what Hashem ordered me to teach you, so I teach you those laws that wherever you go, you have to respect them. Especially there is some special laws that they are related to Israel, like the Shemitah, like the Beit HaMikdash, to build the Beit HaMikdash, like to do sacrifice. There is a lot of mitzvot that you cannot do them nowhere in the world, only in Israel. So Hashem, he said to Moshe Rabbeinu, he teach Moshe Rabbeinu Torah that you can, wherever you are in the world, you will respect them. And even in Israel, there is some mitzvot that are related to Eretz Israel. And Moshe Rabbeinu said, "Ushmatem va'asitem." You have to keep them, do them. Kiyeh chokhmatchem ubinatchem le'ine amim. By doing them, the whole nations of the world, they will be shocked. They will see that you are really good people. And the nations will say, Rak am chacham benavon hagoy hagadol hazeh. I mean, it's not logic. Like, for instance, you have to be very strong to keep Shabbat. There is a lot of laws about Shabbat. We think because we go to shul on Shabbat, so we think this is the laws, because we do Kiddush. No, there is a lot of laws about Shabbat, how to behave, how to wear clothes, how these thousands of laws of Shabbat. Maybe we know 10%, 20%. I mean, sometimes you cannot move. You know, it's like with your finger to make a mark. It's just imagine you are sitting on the floor, and you want to take, you know, to pull out from the ground something, you know, something smell good. You're not allowed. You're not allowed even to scratch a little bit the land. Do you imagine you are in the sea? Do you imagine, and you start to do with your fingers, you know, like you do a little bit of hole, you know, you are not allowed. And people think it's nothing. I'm playing. Yes, you can play, but not on Shabbat. On Shabbat, if you do that, I mean, can you imagine keeping Nida, not to touch your wife during sometimes 15 days. I mean, people don't understand. A young man just got married, he just got married. He's not allowed to touch his wife, you know, since that night till she goes to the mikveh, and then after as well, when she's needed 50 days, there is sometimes some women that they cannot have, they don't have a regular time. Sometimes take them 2 months. I know a woman that poor lady. It's been 1 year that she's always Nida, and her husband is very strong, never touch her. I mean, it's incredible. Those kind of mitzvot are very, very strong. And to keep the Shemitah, is something incredible. To work your land during 6 years, and the 7 year, you cannot work it, you know. You have to give up your land. Anyone who wants to take the fruit can come in and take. You are not allowed to tell nothing. It's very, very hard to be Jew. You are on the plane. They forgot to bring you kosher food. Well, then they ask you, we give you something. No, thank you very much. How many times I forgot to bring with me my kosher food? I forgot because sometimes... I decided to travel, and then I took nothing, and there was no kosher food, and I had to fast, you know, 12 hours, 15 hours, not to eat. And just drink water, coffee and water. That's it. I mean, you show yourself that you dominate your desire, you dominate your envy, you dominate everything. This is a match. Moshe Rabbeinu said to the Bnei Israel, by keeping Torah mitzvot, the people, the nations, we think you are so clever, we think how much strong you are. I mean, to be strong, it's not big strong. I am strong with a strong body. Oh, I have to be strong-minded. How to not to get angry, how to open my heart to people, to help people. That's what Hashem, he said to Moshe Rabbeinu, tell the Bnei Israel, those mitzvot that I teach you, you have to respect them. Wherever you go, you are in Israel, you do them. You are in the exile, you do them. Only through that, you will have a success wherever you go. My friend, I know a lot of times, and a lot of, one day I remember I was going to shul, and it was on Sukkot, and I had my lulav and my etrog in my hand, and I went to shul, and there was a non-Jew, a neighbor, that he told me, Rabbi, I want to ask you one question. Every year, this time, I see people like you walking with this bouquet de fleurs. You think it's like a flowers, you know, but, you know, it's because it's green, you know. I want to know, what's this? Once in a year, this time, by October, I see, and beside this, from my balcony, like people you build like a sukkah, he didn't tell me sukkah, like a house, you put, you know, some trees there, and then you sing, I hear you singing, what's going on? Once a year you do that, what's this? I told him, you will never understand. Even if I explain you, you will not understand. Please, Rabbi, I'm so curious. You are the only one who can explain me this. Because otherwise, I remember it was 20 years ago. At that time, there was no Google, there was no internet, there was nothing. So he has a problem. Today, if you want to know something, you do research and you find. But at that time, it was 20 years ago, maybe a little bit more. It was not easy to know. But he wanted to ask me. What can I tell him? What kind of answer I can tell him? You know what it is, the lulav. To you, I can tell you this. To you, I can tell you that on Sukkot, we take the lulav, we take the etrog, the lulav, the etrog with the left hand, because the etrog represents the heart. The lulav is the body. So we took the body and we declare to Hashem that we love you. Thank you, Hashem, for Rosh Hashanah, for Kippur, for all the forgiveness that you forgive us. And so it's like, you know, a symbolic that we love you, Hashem, with all our body, with our heart. You know, it's symbolic. And then we pray to Hashem, and according to the Kabbalah, when we do, we remove the etrog, the lulav, it's like we push off all the bad angels that they've been created, you know, through our sin, and they did not completely disappear. So with the etrog, the lulav, we declare to Hashem that we love Him. So all this kind of bad things that have been created by us, they disappear. That I can tell you. But to that Frenchman, can I tell him this? He will not understand me. He will think I am crazy. So, I told him, one day I'll tell you. He said, okay, one day you will tell me. But what about that house, the sukkah? I heard, he told me, I asked, he told me a sukkah. What's this? What can I tell him? What can I tell? Can I tell him that the sukkah will invite Abraham, Avinu, Yitzhak, Yaakov, David, Amelech, Moshe Rabbeinu? You know, each day we invite a guest of honor. The first day it's Abraham, the second day it's Yitzhak. And why we invite them there? Because during Rosh Hashanah and Kippur, all our tefillah, Hashem remember Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, Hashem remember Moshe, Aaron, Hashem remember, with Den Zichut, Hashem forgive us. So on Sukkot, we invite them. Can you imagine, if I tell him, on Sukkot, we are with Hashem, the Sukkah, to remember the miracles that Hashem did with us in the desert during 40 years, and now, we do that we leave our home because the house is material. So we declare to Hashem that Hashem, we love you so much that we want to save you even outside. I mean, not to be Jew only in the house. A lot of people, unfortunately, today, you ask them, you eat kosher? They said, yes, I eat kosher in the house. Well, but outside the house, unfortunately, I don't eat kosher. So I tell them, why do you have two stomachs? A kosher stomach and a tarif stomach. It's the same stomach. Are you crazy? It's the same stomach that turn on your body. What's that? But they think house is special, but outside the house it's for everybody. No, you cannot be a Jew in the house and a half Jew outside the house. No, you have to be all of you. Oh, you are all of you, or you are nothing. So my friend, on Sukkot, we declare to Hashem, Hashem, we love you in the house, we love you outside the house. And we know that everything came from you. And we bring the bracha outside. If we want to have panasa, from where you get the panasa? We get it from the outside. The business, we do it from the outside. If I have my office inside my house, but all the work has been done from outside my house. So we bring the bracha through the sukkah, we bring the bracha from the outside. That Hashem provide me my bracha when I go outside, protect me up from at the outside from bad influence, from bad people, from bad accidents. You know, we need to be protected in the house. We are more or less protected, but outside the house, we don't know. You know, my grandfather Rabbi Chaim Pinto, alav shalom, all the time, before he leaves the house, he kissed the mezuzah and he asked Hashem, Hashem, protect me till I come back home. When he come back home, he kissed the mezuzah again. Thank you, Hashem, that you bring me back home. So this is what can I tell him? Can I tell him all this to that non-Jew? Can I tell him that I invite our parents? I remember my father, alav shalom. I remember when I was a baby, before he entered the sukkah, he used to invite Abraham Abino the first night. The second night, he invited Yitzhak. I saw nothing. I didn't see no Abraham. I didn't see Yitzhak. Every day he invites. Every day, like I do the same. And one day I asked my father, Papa, did you see Abraham Abino? I was a baby. He told me, and you saw something? I said, no. So he said, well, when you grow, you will see. So I grow. Did I see something? Nothing. But what I see? Re'e. The parasha of this week is Re'e Anuchi Noten Lachem Bracha Uklala. The parasha of this week is look. Look at the bracha I give you. What this is the bracha? When you respect Torah mitzvot, this is the bracha. What it is the curse, klala. Klala, if you don't respect. Unfortunately, if you don't respect, you bring on you all bad things, God forbid. But the bracha is when you do things, good things. So I remember one fellow, he saw nothing, but he was imuna. When you have imuna, you see everything. I mean, do I see Hashem? No. But we said, Shiviti Hashem Yigdi Tamid. Always you have to consider to feel like Hashem is in front of you. The Pekabot said, Da Malim Ala Mimach. Look up what is above you. What? I look, nothing. This is, there is what? There is nothing. So if you think like that, so it's not. When you look up, it's Hashem. Always, da' malima alamimach, ayin ro'ah, there is eyes who look at you. The Pekabot don't say, re'e malim alamim, look what there is up above you, because you cannot see Hashem. But da', you have to know. But to know something, I have to look. I mean, how can you know? If you tell me, do you know Rabbi Pinto? If I know him, I know him. If I don't know him, I don't know him. Do you know the Lubavitch Rebbe? If I know him, I know him. If I don't know him, I don't know him. If I heard of him, so I heard of him. You ask me, do you know Hashem? I will tell you, yes, of course. Have you seen him? No. So how can you know him? Well, you know Hashem only through the mitzvot. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu said, Re'eh, look. Ta'amu o kitov Hashem. When you do mitzvot, the more you do mitzvot, you will test, you will see who is Hashem. Ta'amu o kitov Hashem. So, back to my story with that man. What can I tell him? So I was thinking million things, what to tell him, what do we do there? What? He's curious, he wants to know. Every year there is a sukkah, every day people are singing, every year, what can I tell him? I told him, if I tell you why we do sukkah, you're going to laugh at me. So he said, I will not laugh. Just tell me. At the sukkah, it's very symbolic. In the sukkah, we have to feel Hashem is with us in the sukkah. We have to thank all the tzaddikim that they've been our lawyers during Rosh Hashanah and Kippur. You understand me? You look at me. He said, no, I don't understand. So I told him, you know, to understand me, you have to be a Jew. Magiv der barav li'akov chokav u'mishpatav li'israel. There is a lo asachen l'chol goy. U'mishpatim ba'yidahom, hallelujah. There is a pasuk we say every morning in the tefillah. Only to the Bnei Israel Hashem he give the Torah and mitzvot. A Jew, he was built up since he was born. To adapt on him the Torah and mitzvot. Such a thing, it doesn't exist to no nation. But there is few things that the nations, when you do them, they will understand. Maybe they will not understand why we do Pesach, why we do Sukkot, why we do Shabbat. Maybe they will not understand. Maybe, I don't know. But one thing they will understand, how you behave. Think that you can do them, be a nice man, a good person. That you can understand. I was reading this morning about this Admor, this Rebbe who passed away today, the Admor Zdigora, that one day, one of his Hasidim, he lost everything. And he started to have a depression, that man. And the Rabbi called him. He told him, look, Hashem give you, Hashem he took from you. So what? You cannot give like before. So what? Say it's you have to believe. Hashem owe you nothing. He give you, he take from you. So what? Maybe he will give you back. You know what? Let's every day we will study Torah together. You know what's this? To study Torah with the Rebbe. What? With you? Yes, with me. And I want you to sit next to me every time. When there is a tish, sit next to me. That's good quality. We don't see this. I mean, we don't see this. A man who don't steal, a man who is nice to the Jew, to the non-Jew, a man who respects people, wherever you are. The Jewish people, if they behave good with toward nations, the nations will be surprised. They will be shocked. You know what they will say? En ki hochmatchem. This is your wisdom. By keeping Torah mitzvot. You know, the nations, when they see how you are very keen, how you be careful not to steal money from nobody, and you are nice with nobody, you are smiling with everybody, people will be proud of you. You know, the Rama, a big tzaddik, is buried in Krakow. The Rama, he wrote the Shulchan Aruch, the Book of Laws that wrote Rabbi Yosef Karo, and there is there the Mappa, there is there the Rama. The Rama is Ashkenaz. He had what the Ashkenazim did do, because Rabbi Yosef Karo is Sephardi. But there is some laws that they are only for the Sephardi. So the Rama said, no, for everybody, it's for everybody. But there is some minhagim that you add in the Shulchan Aruch that we, the Ashkenazim, we don't do that. You know how old was it, the Rama, when he became the chief rabbi of Krakow? He was 18. At that time, the king of Poland, when he heard that the chief rabbi of Krakow was the Rama, and he is 18 years old, he was laughing. He said, they're crazy, the Jewish people, to have a chief rabbi like this, a young man. So he invited him. He wanted to know who he is. When he started to talk to him, he saw that the Rama, Rabbi Moshe Aserles, his name, Alav Shalom, he knew everything. Everything. The king was so, he couldn't believe that a young man like that, he knows everything. Mathematics, algebra, Torah, languages. How he did? Well, my friend, when a man, he wants to be at the service of Hashem, so Hashem will open him all the doors. He can understand what people don't understand. I have here a big tzaddik, alav shalom. He was 22 years old when he passed away. He was one of the biggest tzaddikim of Turkish, Rabbi Rafael Alevi. And he wrote a book that his name Kol Ben Levi. And the book that he wrote, he was only 22 years old. the book that he wrote, all big rabbis, they bring his book. About Yosef, all the big rabbis, how he did, 22-year-old, when he passed away. He passed away because it was an epidemic in Turkey. My friend, Rabbi Chaim Pinto, my grandfather, the first Rabbi Chaim Pinto, he was 18-year-old when he became the chief rabbi of Essaouira. How he did? Well, my friend, there is people who win the lotto and they become billionaire, and there is people they become rich because they work very hard. So it's the same. The Jewish people, when they left Egypt, Hashem gave them the Torah. They understood everything. But when they did the golden calf, they forgot everything. Now Hashem told them, if you want to understand, you got the lotto, now you lost the lotto because you did the golden calf. Now you have to study Torah with effort. With effort. Look, Moshe Rabbeinu alav shalom, how much effort he did to enter Eretz Israel. He prayed 515 tefillot to have the zichut to enter Eretz Israel. And Hashem, he said, no. Why Moshe Rabbeinu did all this? Why he wanted to enter Israel for the fruit? The Gemara said, why? Why? What was the reason? The Gemara answered, because Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to respect, to do all the mitzvot that they are related to Eretz Israel. That was Moshe Rabbeinu alav shalom. My friend, back to that man. The next year, again, he asked me, can you tell me why you do the lulav? Why you do the sukkah? I told him, every year you will ask me this question? It will be hard for me to explain to you this. So you know what he said? Must be things that no one will understand, only you. Only your people, Jewish people. I said, even we, Jewish people, there's a lot of mitzvot that we don't understand why we do them. Like not to eat taref, why? Not to eat pig, why? Why? Not to eat bacon, chas v'shalom, why? Not to eat meat and milk and butter and cheese, why? Not to touch a woman that she's nida, why? A lot of mitzvot we know, don't steal, don't kill. There's a lot of mitzvot that it's logic. But there is mitzvot that are not logic. We don't understand them. Why? But we are built to respect them. This is our emuna. This is our emuna. All those tzaddikim that we will see now in Morocco, how they become tzaddikim? You think they become tzaddikim only because it's easy to become a tzaddik? It's not easy. To be a tzaddik, you have to choose. Or I live my life, or I live in this world the life that Hashem, for Hashem. You know, the tzaddikim, they enjoyed life. Don't think they did not enjoy life. They enjoy life. But they enjoy more the respect of Hashem, because up there is no mitzvot. Up there, after 120 years, like this tzaddik that they are buried now at this moment, once he arrived there is nothing, there is no tish, there is no pray, there is no Sukkah, there is no Shabbos, there is no Kippur, there is nothing up there. It's finished, there is no mitzvot up there. The mitzvot are only here. Only here. And once he arrives there, he will miss all the mitzvot that we do here. But there, it's like you're on holiday. There it's holiday, there is no work, nothing. Just you enjoy being with Hashem. But work, it's him. There is the time of work, time to rest. The time of work is this world. Time of the rest, like we say, may his soul rest in peace, the body rest in peace, yeah, after all the 20 years. But for the moment, not nothing. For the moment, it's work. And the Yitzhara will not let you work. But Baruch Hashem, re'eh, that the parasha of this week, re'eh, look what? HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives us a special vision. A Jew has a vision. A Torah vision. I repeat, HaKadosh Baruch Hu created on the Jew a special vision. Re'eh, look, I give you the Torah. It's a blessing. Re'eh natati lifnechem. Re'eh anochi noten lifnechem hayom. Beracha uklala. And look. And there is. And that through that vision, you can see the beracha. And through that vision, you can see as well the klala, the curse. If something happened to you, God forbid, you have to know why. Because you didn't respect the beracha, the Torah. Look, when we have a problem, we must find out a reason why. I mean, we cannot say it's nothing. No, the Gemara said, when you see you have a problem, you have to look out. Why there is a problem? And if you see that you did nothing wrong, everything is good, so why I have a problem? Well, the reason is, maybe you did not respect Torah as you should be. Maybe you did not do mitzvot as you should do. My friend, now we're going to go to Morocco. Monsieur Bensoussan, on va aller au Maroc. Now we're going to go to Morocco, to Marrakech, to this cemetery that we call it the cemetery of Hisham Baklofi.
Bonjour, Rabbi David, et pour l'Amérique.
Ça va? So here, my friend, we are in front of a big tzaddik, Rabbi David Ben Hazan, alav shalom. He was the friend with Rabbi Chaim Pinto in Morocco. And he came to Marrakesh for a judgment, because he was a big dayan with Rabbi Chaim Pinto. And unfortunately, he passed away on Marrakesh. And he is buried inside. On peut rentrer à l'intérieur?
Oui.
And
on est à la compagnie de Monsieur Isaac. Oui.
There is here our friend, Monsieur Ayon. He is the president of... Here you have the kevora of the tzaddik Rabbi David Ben Hazan. On his kever, we go inside. There is two graves. One of Rabbi David Ben Hazan alav shalom, one of Rabbi Abraham Azulay. Two big tzaddikim. And it's written on the grave of Rabbi David Ben Hazan that he used to study Torah with Eliyahu HaNavi. It's very, very, there is a lot of graves on this cemetery of Marrakesh that it's written on the grave that they were studying Torah with Eliyahu HaNavi. Eliyahu HaNavi, it's only on, when there is a Brit Mila, we invite Eliyahu HaNavi to come. Eliyahu Navi is the one, the prophet Eliyahu, the one that he will come to announce the Be'ezat Hashem, Mashiach. As you are Eliyahu HaNavi. Shikara Vishana, he was a big Mikubal, he was the friend of Rabbi Chaim Pinto. He passed away like last week, a week ago. Last week, Tzayin Menachem Av. Last week. My name is David because I was named after him. I was named after Rabbi David ben Hazan and Rabbi David ben Baruch alav shalom. And next to him, it's Rabbi Abraham Azulay. Akote, Rabbi Abraham Azulay was a very famous, big nisim that he did. Look what it's written. Hamlumad banisim amkubal ha'elaki. It was a lot of miracles. He did a lot of miracles. It was a bit tzaddik like Rabbi Chaim Pinto, alav shalom. And there is a story. So he passed away 1832. Yes. And there is a lot of stories about him. One of the stories that there is about him is that after he passed away, he used to come in a dream every Erev Shabbat. There is some who said on a dream, and there is some who said he used to come to do the Kiddush to his wife. Yeah. There are two beautiful stories. Now we go. Hicham, on va aller.
Oui,
et alors, allez-y pour aller ailleurs. Now we're going to go look at this beautiful cemetery. All done. It's the two brothers Ohayon, one of these. They are big businessmen in Marrakesh, but they took the responsibility to repair all this beautiful cemetery. Thousands of graves. You never saw that in your life. And behind this cemetery is the palace of the king. Now we're gonna go. To a place. It's a new place. It's a place of the Mekubalim, Rabbi Shlomo Amar, and his Talmidim, and his student, with a big Mekubal. Big Tzaddik, big Mekubal. The light candles here. Every time I go to Morocco, I come to this place. Alav Shalom, big tzaddik. A lot of miracles he did. Of course, all his students, they were big tzaddikim, just like him. Yeah. Amkubal ha'elaki, Arab ha'gadol, Amfursam, Ampulpal. He was the Abidin of, he was the the big Dayan, chief rabbi of Marrakesh, at the year of 5498 year, few hundred years ago. Hicham, on peut partir. Rabbi David Bechazan, alav shalom. They wanted to take him to Isawira, where he belonged, but his body, no one could move it. So it was very hot here in Marrakesh, very, very hot. So they did not know what to do. And suddenly Rabbi Chaim Pinto, he told them, because he came to Marrakesh with Rabbi Chaim Pinto from Isawira. So Rabbi Chaim Pinto told them that maybe we have to bury him here. You remember, you have to know that a few hundred years ago, there was no cars. There was nothing. So they have to travel by horse. It will take 1 week to arrive to Isawira. So Rabbi Chaim Pinto decided that to bury him here in Marrakesh. Here, now we enter a big tzaddik, Rabbi Hananiah HaKohen. Big, big tzaddik. Maybe 600-700 years ago, he passed away. He was among the first tzaddikim who came to Marrakesh. Big, big, very, very, very well known in all Morocco. Rabbi Hananiah HaKohen. Now you know why my name is Hananiah? Because I was named after this tzaddik, Rabbi Hananiah HaKohen. So my name is David Hananiah. David for Rabbi David Bechazan, and Hananiah because when my mother, she was pregnant, she couldn't have me. So my father, Alav Asalom, he prayed with the zichut of Rabbi Hananiah HaKohen and Rabbi David Baruch. And I was born in my house, not in the hospital. And Baruch Hashem, when I was born, my father gave me the name David Hananiah. So now you know the secret why my name is David Hananiah. David HaMelech, Rabbi David Baruch, Rabbi David Bechazan, and Rabbi Hananiah HaKohen. Alav Shalom. You can pray now. So, because he was a Kohen, so we do the Barakha Adonai Vishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai Panah Velecha Vechoneka, Yisa Adonai Panah Velecha Vyasim Lecha Shalom. Be'ezat Hashem. What a privilege we have to be here next to this big tzaddikim. Now we go somewhere else. Look what huge cemetery, very, very big. The king of Morocco, may Hashem give him good health. He gave a lot of money from his pocket to repair all this cemetery. This cemetery cost maybe a few million dollars to repair it, because I remember 20 years ago, it was completely destroyed. Completely destroyed. You would not recognize nothing. And Baruch Hashem, the king of Morocco, he respects the rabbis. He respects a lot the rabbis. And his father, King Hassan the Second, may his soul rest in peace, he told his son, the king of Morocco, if you want to be blessed, don't lay down the Jewish people. It's not only he didn't know to lead down the Jewish people, that all our souvenirs, all our rabbis, he took them under his responsibility. Here we have a big tzaddik, a big tzaddik, deluya, and another big tzaddik, the Abraham ben Attar, alav shalom. Very, very, very well known tzaddikim. Very, very, very well known tzaddikim. May Rabbi Yitzchak Deluya alav shalom. Monsieur Ayon, do you know quelque chose sur Rabbi Yitzchak Deluya?
Je parle en hébreu?
Non, personne ne parle en hébreu, en français si vous voulez.
D'accord. Alors, Rabbi Yitzchak Deluya, c'est lui qui a construit la synagogue, certainement.
Ah!
C'est lui qui a construit la synagogue, il était à Bétine, à Marrakech. Et il est arrivé ici en 1492, et voilà, tu vois, sur la tombe, c'est écrit « Osez chez Gibre Imaran Akadosh ».
Wow.
Il y a beaucoup d'histoires avec le Bitzhak Deluya, Bishmo Bintamsot, c'est très long, vous racontez.
Ouais, ouais, ouais,
ouais. De toute façon, tu dis au Rav, qui me bénit ma fille.
Kakash Baruchu.
Pour un zivou,
Abigail Nazal Bat. Il donne le bracha, un bon mazal, Be'ezat Hashem. Zivug, Be'karov, Be'ezat Hashem. Be'karov. So, Be'itzhak Diluya, Allah Vashem, who is the Abidin of Marrakesh as well. And Rabbi, he studied Torah with Rabbi Yosef Karo, Allah Vashalom. Maran HaKadosh. Very good. And next one is Abbe Avraham Al-Attar, Alav Shalom, big tzaddik. He was a Rosh Yeshiva, very well known. Let's go. Bon, on va aller, Hisham, on va sortir.
Rabbi Moshe
Haliwa. Now we're going to go to a big tzaddik, Rabbi Moshe Haliwa, Alav Shalom. So Rabbi Moshe Haliwa, he was the grandfather of my daughter-in-law, the wife of Rabbi Rafael Pinto. So this is his grandfather. Big, big, big tzaddik. One night, I was in Marrakech about 30 years ago. Listen to this story. I was in Marrakech one night, and I was in the hotel with a group of people, maybe 25 years ago, 30, I think 20, yeah, maybe 30, 25 years. I don't remember exactly. And it was midnight, and I was reading his book. And his book, it's a Kabbalah book. Here is Rabbi Moshe Haliwa alav shalom. It's a Kabbalah book with a big, 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 big tzaddik. And in the middle of reading his book, I heard that, I feel that something was in my room. I was scared. I thought maybe I was not, I didn't have the merit, the zechut to read. Because really I was reading something very Kabbalistic. Outside, you know, I cannot tell you because I don't want to scare people. So I closed the book and I waited till 10 years later. And then I understood all what he meant in his book. Maybe I was not ready yet to discover some secret Kabbalistic in the Torah. That's why I was very, very scared. Big tzaddik, alav shalom, he was a light of Torah. He was very, 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 very well known. And next to him, there is another tzaddik. We're gonna go now. Big. Look, most of those tombs There is no names. Some of them, as I told you, they've been destroyed. Since the Jewish people left 40 years ago, with the rain, everything. And Baruch Hashem, Mr. Ohayon, with his brother, they took care with the money of some people he gave, but most of the money came from the king of Morocco. May Hashem bless him and give him a long life. Look, thousands of times. Now we're going to go to a place that you will be surprised to see. As you know, my family, the Pinto family, some of them went to Holland, Turkey, Syria. Some of them came after the acquisition, because we are all from Portugal. So some of them, they went to Morocco, Holland, Syria, Turkey. And those who came to Morocco, some of them came to Marrakesh, and some of them went to Agadir, from Agadir to Essaouira. So there is two families, Marrakesh and Essaouira. So you will find Rabbi Chaim Pinto as well. There is one Rabbi Chaim Pinto who is buried in Marrakesh. And there is Rabbi Yaakov Pinto, Baal Mikdash Melech. A big, big, there is one, his name is Rabbi Yeshua Pinto. Rabbi Yeshua Pinto was reading in the middle of the night, and some, a ganav, somebody was still, he came to the house, and he lost his way in the house. Wherever, when he wanted to go out, he couldn't find his way. Rabbi Yeshua Pinto, alav shalom, he told him, What are you doing here? He said, I want to get out. He said, you want to get out? Get out. He said, I don't find the door. So, leave what you talk, and you will find the door. He left, he was scared. He left what he talk, and the door opened. Suddenly, he looked at the door. I think this is the place all the Pinto of Marrakesh, big tzaddikim, a part of the Pinto, they are all buried here. They give them a special place as respect. All the stumps are Pinto family. Where all those Mishpahat Rabbanim, Mishpahat Pinto. All those Kevorot are Pinto family. They buried them. They buried them all together. All big tzaddikim, all big rabbi. This was Rabbi Yosef. And some of the tzaddikim as well. Look how old it is. Yosef Harbon, alav shalom. Rabbi Abraham Pinto, alav shalom, the son of Rabbi Yaakov Pinto, the grandson of Rabbi Abraham Pinto. Big, big tzaddikim. So, Rabbi Mordechai Avtan, alav shalom. Well, may the zechut be all with you, be'atzat Hashem. They renew the temps. They renew the temps. This is Rabbi Yaakov Pinto. He was a big, big tzaddik. Big tzaddik. He was like a big mikubal. Big, big mikubal. Look, the old tamp is there. This is the new. The old stones, as you see above, and this is the new stone that they put. Every year we used to go to Morocco. Rabbi Mimoun Pinto, Alav Shalom, the son. Look, the old stone and the new stone. The son of Rabbi Yitzhak Pinto, Alav Shalom. And this is Rabbi Yitzhak Pinto, Alav Shalom. Look at all it is. And next to him is Rabbi Moshe Pinto, Alav Shalom. Not my father, another Rabbi Moshe Pinto. All big tzaddikim, all big tzaddikim. What a zichut you have. Those brothers, Ohayon brothers, that they give us this opportunity to come. Rabbi Abraham Pinto again. Big, big study. Look, the old stone, the new stone. Rabbi Mis'ud Pinto, Alav Shalom. Big, big tzaddik. In the meantime that you visit, you pray. Rabbi Reuben Pinto, the son of Rabbi Abraham. He wrote a book, Mor Deror. The son of Rabbi Yaakov Pinto, Baal Mikdash Melech. Rabbi Abraham Azulay, Alav Shalom, big Mikubal. Est-ce qu'on peut aller à, à Bipin Hazakohen?
Oui, on va aller tout de suite là-bas.
Ah.
Bidavid.
Oui.
Tous ces temples que vous voyez ici, les bleus, vous savez que ce sont des bits. Et moi, j'ai creusé et on a trouvé ça à 51 mètres de profondeur, des temples entièrement. Et tous ces plats que vous voyez ici maintenant, on les a trouvés à côté de chaque temple.
Waouh.
C'est des grands sadiques. Ceux-là, ils se sont. C'est eux qui se sont montrés pour nous. On savait, il y avait ici une chambre vide.
Je me rappelle. Je me rappelle. He said that he dig a meter. Because I remember before, we couldn't see nothing. So he said that he had to dig 1 meter and he found the, he found the look, this is the original, what he found. Big work. Voilà, Kavod.
Et tous ces temples qu'il y a en plan au petit, c'est les enfants, les petits-enfants de la famille Pinto. Tous, c'est des grands sadiques.
He said, all those temples round, they are their children of the Pinto family. They were big, big tzaddikim.
Voilà, tous ces temples, on a creusé, on a trouvé même les matzevot à côté. En 50
centimètres. By digging under the ground, look what they found. Look what they found. Because no one took care of them. So with the dust, with the stones, so they've been covered, like the kotel, today you see the kotel is very, very high. But because they dig, they find, it's a big work, I think, what a privilege. I'm looking forward to go to Morocco. Oh la la. After this epidemic, please God, to go to pray. Now we're going to go to Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen. Now we're going to go to Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen. Big Tzaki, he was the grandson of Rabbi David Ben Baruch. Alav Shalom. Look what big it is. Thousands of... Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen, Alav Shalom, he was a very close friend to the king of Morocco. And one day, Rabbi Pinchas, the one who, was in charge of Marrakesh, the mayor of Marrakesh, he went, Rabbi Shlomo, Abitbol Alavash, big tzaddik, you can pray. Big tzaddik, Bishlomo Abitbol.
Bishlomo Abitbol.
Alav Shalom.
On a trouvé aussi la tombe de Bishlomo Abitbol, qui est un grand Gadol Absolim Eximot Israël. Bishlomo Abitbol, c'est le Biralam Abitbol, c'est son fils. Et lui, il a sorti la chanson qui est populaire aujourd'hui, Yafa Vitama, c'est plus de 120 ans.
Aïe, aïe, aïe. This is the one. Mr. Ohayon, he lives in Morocco still. He's a big businessman, but he's so connected to Tzadikim. When we called him to make us visit this Tzadikim today, he closed his business, he left everything and he came. And Rabbi Pinchas Alav Hashem HaKohen, he went to see the mayor of Marrakesh and he told him, tomorrow don't drink the cafe that they will make you because they put there poison. They want to kill you. So he told him, how can I know? He said, well, the one who brings you the this is a grandson of Rabbi Chaim. All the tzaddikim. So the next day, they bring him the cafe, and the mayor of Marrakesh, he told him, drink it. He said, no. Drink it. He said, no. So they forced him to drink, and after 5 minutes, he passed away. He died. They wanted to kill him. And who saved him? Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair. Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen. This is tzaddik. So beautiful. So here, it's here, the people who pass away now. It's new. Now, you see, where we've been before, it's old. Tzadikim passed away 500 years ago, 600 years ago. Here, only the last 50 years. And here, big tzadik, Rabbi Shlomo HaKohen, Alav HaShalom, Rabbi Mesaud Hamyas. Big, big, big tzadikim. Very, 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 very well known tzadikim. Wish I could go back to Morocco again, just to be here for a while. We arrived to Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen, Alav HaShalom. He was a big friend of Rabbi Chaim Pinto, my grandfather. Now we enter to Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen, big tzaddik. He was a big friend of Rabbi Chaim Pito, my grandfather. One day, Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen, he was the grandson of Rabbi David Ben Baruch. He was a big tzaddik, big tzaddik. I told you a story about him, but there is another story that from Marrakesh, he used to go every year to the grave of his grandfather, Rabbi David Ben Baruch. So Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen passed away 1952. That means when I was 2 years old. I am 70 now, so 68 years ago he passed away. Rabbi Pinchas Khalifa HaKohen Azog Alav HaShalom. So one day, every time that he go to Tarodon, he go to Rabbi Chaim Pito, he speaks with him, stay with him. But one year, he had no time, he had to go to right away to Tarodon without stopping in Isawera. You know what happened? The car broke. So what happened? It happened that he said, well, it seemed that Rabbi Chaim Pinto punished us. So 1 hour later, they saw Rabbi Chaim Pinto coming in that junction, because from Marrakesh to Agadir, there is a junction, one for Agadir, one for Isawira, and there the car broke. And Rabbi Chaim Pinto arrived. So he told Rabbi Pinchas, what happened? Every year you come to see me. Why you didn't come? He said, I'm sorry, Rabbi. It's not my fault, because I am a little bit in a hurry. So Rabbi Chaim Pinto, he said, what you are used to do every year, you have to carry on doing it. Every year you come to see me, you have to carry on coming to see me every year. So they kiss each other, they talk a little bit, and Rabbi Chaim Pito told him, I wish you now a good trip, you can go. So he went. So in the middle of the road, some friends did ask Rabbi Pinchas, why that happened to us, that the car broke? What, Rabbi Chaim Pito is more stronger than you? He said, no, we are the same, but this is his territory. And that, on his territory, I'm not allowed to do nothing. It's like, this is his root. His root is Isawira and around Isawira. So, those are the tzaddikim. Well, thank you very much for praying. We pray to Hashem that the corona will stop, Be'ez Hashem. Good health for all of you. Good panasa kineratzon. And I will see you next Tuesday. We will have some more surprise for you. Be'ezat Hashem. Here is Isawira. Here is Marrakesh. Beautiful city of Marrakesh. All the tzaddikim.